Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayam Naman, Narayam Naman Krishna. No, Krishna. Naram Chaiva Narottamam. Devim Sarasvatim Vyasam. Tato Jaya Mudirae. Nashta Praeshu Abhadreshu. Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya. Bhagavati Uttama Shloke. Bhaktir Bhavati Naishtaki. So we are reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 10, Chapter 69, entitled Narad Visits Krishna's Palaces, Text 30. Jayantam ekam masinam. Dhyayantamekamasinam Purusham prakrute param Shushushantam gurum kvapi Kamer bhogai saparyaya Dhyayantamekamasinam Purusham prakrute param Shushushantam gurum kvapi Kamer bhoge saparyaya Jayayantamekam asinam Purusham prakrute param Shushushantam gurum kvapi Kamer bhoge saparyaya Dhyayantamekamasinam Purusham prakrute param
Shushushantam gurum kvapi Kamer bhoge saparyaya
Dhyayantamekamasinam
Purusham prakrute param
Shushushantam gurum kvapi Kamer bhoge saparyaya Dhyayantamekamasinam Purusham prakrute param Shushushantam gurun vapi Kamer bhoge saparyaya Matajis Dhyayantamekamasinam Purusham prakrute param Shushushantam gurum kvapi Kamer bhoge saparyaya Dhyayantam Meditating Ekam Alone Asinam Sitting Purusham On the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Prakriti, to material nature, Param, transcendental, Shushushantam, rendering menial service, Gurun, to his elders, Kva api, somewhere, Kame, desirable, Bhoge, with objects of enjoyment, saparyaya, and with worship. Translation by humble servants of His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. Somewhere he was sitting alone, meditating on the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is transcendental to material nature, and somewhere he was rendering menial service to his elders, offering them desirable things, and reverential worship. purport. Srila Prabhupada comments, meditation, as recommended in authorized scripture, is meant for concentrating one's mind on the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Vishnu. Lord Krishna is himself the original Vishnu, but because he played the part of a human being, he taught us definitely by his personal behavior what is meant by meditation. This activity of meditation indicates the Brahma Murta, the early morning hours before sunrise. Om Ajnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhaktivedanta Swami Tinamine Namaste Saraswati Deva Gauravani Pracharine Nivishesha Shunyavadi Paschata Deshatarine. So in this chapter, Narad Muni, we have come to see most of this chapter, there is still some more to go. But the essence of this chapter is Krishna is displaying through Narad his various pastimes in Dwarka, in his palaces, among his queens, his consorts. Here he talks about meditation and worshipping the elders. Elsewhere, the range of activities that Krishna personally does, and even Rukmini, you know, rendering menial service and worshipping the Supreme, serving the spiritual master, rendering whatever services he can to the elders, the feeding the Brahmins, charity, and also activities which we may consider mundane, like coddling the infants. These are the words which actually Prabhupada uses, coddling the infants, arranging marriages for his daughters and sons, playing in the water with his female companions, having joking and exchanging joking words and with his consorts, also going in disguise to find out, since he's a king, that's his responsibility, to find out what others actually think about him, just like Lord Ram used to do. So basically he's displaying the ideal role of not only a king, but he's also displaying how one should lead one's life, a married life. Because Krishna is Krishna, so he doesn't have to, he's only doing it for his loving exchanges, and through Narad Muni we get all the instructions. So it is really a moment to ponder as to if you connect with, because these instructions are applicable for perhaps 99.99999% of the people who will be eventually getting married, or are married, or were married. Often, you know, we get into the concept that marriage means we just, one has to get married, so we have to just do the sattviras, then we live life, and then we have our jobs, we have our children, we have, then temple comes in the picture, in some cases if you are fortunate. So we come to the temple, we worship the deities, we love the deities, we may do some seva. So that is good. But the essence of the ashram and what it means is sometimes forgotten. So it would be worthwhile to just touch base. For instance, when we talk about ashram, there are four ashrams as we know. So this is also an ashram. Generally we think that brahmachari ashram, sannyas ashram, vanprastha ashram. So grihastha we may call it sometimes ashram, but we don't realize, because ashram comes from the word ashray, that means to take shelter. To take shelter of the Lord. It is not to take shelter of anybody material. So basically, that principle often eludes us. We don't really understand that in that sense it is equal in all the ashrams. Only that there are, it is simultaneously equal and different. Equal in the sense that it is, you can make spiritual progress, you can go back to Godhead in this Grihastha ashram itself. But different because it has different responsibilities and different, there are two basic differences. One is that it is, of course, only ashram where there is interaction between the opposite sex, and that there is monetary involvement, there is earning, saving. But being an ashram indicates that Krishna being in the center of all the activities, directly and even indirectly, becomes our anchor. So even so, the difference of say earning, which the other ashrams are not involved in, and this ashram is actually the only ashram which is meant to not only earn but also protect and support the other ashrams, which it is a great honor and esteem, not as a matter of condescension that, well, we are earning, so we are superior. No, it's just actually that is the way the society is evolved, and a civilized society would be one where they understand their responsibilities and take it further. So being an ashram means it's number one that it has it is to take shelter. Number two, it is also like the other ashrams, an ashram of sacrifice. The understanding is that we have liberties, therefore we are out of bounds. This is the only ashram which has privacy, which has relatively speaking, because you know the other ashrams are much more under the microscope. You are you almost all your activities become public knowledge practically. It's very difficult, and that's the way those who inmates accept it. But we should accept that when we talk of privacy, it is privacy from the material world, but Krishna in our hearts know what we do. So there is a certain privacy because there are, you know, family matters and issues like that. But it doesn't get away from the fact that it is an ashram of sacrifice, which means developing selflessness, which can only come when we have when we are serving others. See, we are always serving. Either we are serving our senses or we are serving Krishna. Senses by means of what is meant for us, what we like to do, what we want to enjoy, or what is important for us only. And that becomes the center. And then we are in the middle of the center. But if we are talking of serving others, the service attitude is there, but then instead of we being in the center, if Krishna is in the center, then all our responsibilities may be the same externally, just like Krishna has demonstrated here. You know, playing in the water and coddling his infants, etc., arranging marriages for his children. These are things. So we say, what is the difference? I am also doing it. But if we understand that raising children and what kind of culture we want to bring them in, what kind of background we want to give them, a lifestyle, what kind of lifestyle we want to give, that makes a difference, which may not be apparent externally, but internally that would be our effort. How it manifests is not in our control, because there are so many factors beyond our understanding. But our consciousness, because everything depends on our consciousness to the extent that we can, what are we supposed to do? It's not what we are supposed to be effective in, or what we are supposed to, we are not answerable for the results. We are answerable for our actions, and the actions have to be based on that. So if you understand that it's an ashram of sacrifice, it becomes, it brings meaning to so many activities we do. So it may be that we are, whatever, if you have a job or if we are serving, living in a joint family, so many things we do, but then everything becomes slowly meaningful. And then the third point, it is that even this ashram, like others, the sole goal is devotional service. There is no difference in that. There is absolutely no difference. The Grihastha ashram also means devotional service. Now, devotional service may be of variety of types. And devotional service does not mean, devotion does not mean that there's a physical proximity of coming to 7 km Munshi Mark or Juhu or Meera Road or so on. Devotional service means wherever we accept Krishna and we do it with our consciousness of serving, where we try to improve our lives, trying to understand what is the real meaning and how we can develop to it. Which means we are humble enough to accept corrections or guidance also, and follow certain, to conform to certain rules and standards that are accepted. Otherwise, when so many people say that, you know, they are fanatics, because the opposite of conformist is to just break everything and just not follow anything. That is what people actually want. You know, they today the establishment, the you can say the way the world is situated and the powers that be, the sole focus is always that I, me and mine. So I must be free to do anything I want. The slightest infringement of that and there is an explosion. So when we understand, and we are talking in a at Bhagavatam time, which is meant for devotees, and this is where aspiring devotees like all of us, we understand and we reflect on what Krishna is trying to tell. So here, understanding Grihasta Ashram becomes meaningful when we understand that it is also sometimes we forget that it is an ashram that we have taken shelter of the Lord, also an ashram of sacrifice and devotional services for everyone, including this ashram. So the external changes that we, the difference of renunciation may vary. That is a difference, because at the sannyas and brahmacharya ashram, the renunciation levels are much higher. Here the renunciation levels may be lower. And of course, handling, you know, material, monetary aspects will be more, earning and supporting others. But those are within the principles of Grihastha Ashram. So when we see from that point of view, we then also will accept that the fundamental principles of all living entities as human beings would be that there is how do we develop Nam Ruchi, Jiva Daya and Vaishnava Seva. So these three become the pillars of our activities, the principles. So Nam Ruchi, the chanting the holy names, developing the taste for holy name, which takes a lifetime, but steadily and without any deviation, constantly keeping this in the at the uppermost, because scriptures repeatedly say that how the holy name is the most important and by far the most important, most potent effect. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came in this yoga precisely for demonstrating not only that, but also spoke directly. That he only spoke 8 verses, and in that also the prominence that he has given of how the dirt of from the mirror of our heart gets cleaned by constant chanting. So the holy name is predominant. Vaishnava Seva is clear, that service to all, especially to those who are striving to follow the orders of the Lord. And Jiva Daya means to develop compassion, to have a feeling of sympathy or empathy with people who have challenges in life. We then forget our challenges and we try to help others in whatever way we can, and that becomes our, we feel the pain of others and we'd like to help and see other people happy. So when we look at these principles, oftentimes we get married and then we also feel that this is what is necessary, I have to do this, and we also follow these principles insofar as it is applicable to the to temple activities, to devotees in the maybe in a congregation, in a counseling group, or in our community neighborhood. But we sometimes may not apply to our own families. That the same principles apply to everyone, and especially for ones which we spend the maximum time, and where the comfort or discomfort can hinder or help our Krishna consciousness. To the extent that we have a comfort base at home, to that extent our Krishna consciousness also gets supported. Of course, circumstances may be that in spite of our effort, Krishna may have create turmoil in our life, But then that's oftentimes those are our activities which may create it. And we may say that it is Krishna who's doing it or Krishna has created it. It may be our ego which may be coming in the way. So, therefore, for looking at that, there are some pointers towards it and which would be very useful. And I'd like to quote from Her Grace Vishakha Mataji, Srila Prabhupada's disciple. Many years ago, she gave a talk in Dallas almost a decade ago. And she made some extremely good points, simple points, very practical points, which were very Krishna conscious examples, but the principles were applicable on day-to-day life. For instance, she said that when she was reflecting on, she was talking on relationships in general, particularly in household life. She said, it is easy to live with someone's good qualities, but do you have the courage to live with someone's weaknesses? So, we often forget that we are immediately quick to point out someone's weaknesses or faults, but we forget that someone else is also living with our faults and weaknesses. So, looking at it needs not only courage but it needs humility, because we have to accept our weaknesses and then for the corrections that may follow, the course corrections that may need to be done, but we only look at it one-sidedly. She also said that it is that happiness is not, we don't seek, people are often looking for the perfect person. A person is always looking for a perfect partner. But actually the happiest people are those who look at, who learn to see imperfect people perfectly. You know, there's a difference, a vast difference, that we are always looking that I want the perfect person as my partner, but that will never happen. But if you are able to see, if you can comfortably see and live with the, have the, you know, with the imperfect person, but if you know how to learn how to live perfectly, then that makes all the difference. So these experiences of day-to-day life, you know, you go through a year and 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, as life goes on, there are so many factors that are going on. For devotees, we are struggling in our sadhana, we are struggling with our many factors which affect us around us. We may be earning, we may be having health problems, financial problems, relationship problems with a variety of issues. That's typically of when we are staying in communities or in neighborhoods, etc. But through all this, if we are able to struggling to follow, Krishna will reciprocate. Krishna always reciprocates and He gives us pointers. For instance, if we understand how a principle of contentment, just being contented with what we have, because oftentimes some conflicts are because we are looking at something more than what we have, and we are pushing for or desiring to have, and then the one partner has a bigger need than the other. But if you look at Sudama Vipra's example, was Krishna's best friend, and still, how was he, you know, he and his wife were so poor, but they never ever thought that because we have such a friend, what is, you know, maybe we should get something. But then, when his wife was pushing him to go to Krishna, it was not for herself, because she had so much respect for him, and she couldn't bear to see him, you know, starving and suffering so much. So therefore, her thought was entirely for him. She was contented with what personally what she had, even though they were so poor. But what made her tell him to go to Krishna was not any greed or any desire. It was entirely just that she felt that if there was some improvement in his life, then she'd be happy. So from her wifely duties, it was extremely positive. And from his point of view also, he was always looking to see that if she's suffering so much, is there anything that, because he was reluctant to go to Krishna. He didn't want to ask, but when he was going, he never asked also eventually, but he went only to satisfy his wife, because he didn't want his wife to suffer. So even though they never exchanged those views, but as Shastra, as Krishna has revealed, that the glory of this couple was such that they demonstrated how in utmost poverty they were so happy to live with each other in such conditions and satisfaction. So contentment is another aspect. Then another aspect which we have a problem generally is which affects our Krishna consciousness also because of disputes is the lack of listening. You know, one of the key principles is just to listen. Listen means listen intently, because listening is a sign of respect. Listening gives an indication that you value the other person. Otherwise, generally, you heard but you've not listened. That means you've heard the words but you are already closed-minded. So this is and these principles actually apply everywhere. It is not that we have different principles, but only thing is that they become more acute and sensitive because we happen to spend the maximum time probably with our spouses, and then oftentimes these issues which could be small could become larger, and they can actually mar our Krishna conscious efforts, because when you are disturbed, it becomes our actions and thoughts are centered around those disturbances and rather than what we are meant to be doing. So the peace of mind is lost, and many times we can control that. So this is another that if we are able to listen, therefore, and demonstrate, you may have differences, but these differences, eventually we can learn to live with the differences. Some people's natures are different, people's habits may be different. So instead of getting very irritated, we learn to live with it, and that comes through trying to follow Krishna conscious principles. So that is the beauty of scriptures, that they actually are so practical. There is philosophy for the intellect, and then there is instructions for the emotions, and there is fulfillment for the soul. At all levels, there is these interpretations must be heard from the sadhus, from the learned people, from those who have been given the who have the experience and also the purity to be able to explain. Otherwise, it will be speculation. So, and then there, if we live those principles, we actually see the practicality of it and the effectiveness. Speech is another pointer, which is words that are spoken that have a major impact, because we constantly speak. There are so many aspects of that, and I just want to quote Bhagavad Gita 17.15. Austerity of speech consists of speaking truthfully and beneficially, and in avoiding speech that offends. Austerity of speech is an austerity which consists in speaking truthfully and beneficially, and in avoiding speech that offends. So this gives us everything that we need to know, because first of all we understand how difficult it is to control speech, and the value that is put here of following that austerity of thinking what we speak and understanding, having the sensitivity of how the effect goes on the other person is very invaluable. Actually, studies have shown that 90% of the problems in speech actually come from the tone. It's very interesting. Tone, not the words. First, the tone, sir, because especially when the person is familiar and we are talking to the other person, the very tone, even if the intent may be relatively innocent, but the tone can be, if it is harsh, if it is condescending, if it is like no at all, has a immediately the other person's understanding changes, and it has a very it creates problems. So tone is an issue. Then the motivation, of course, what is our motivation in speaking those words, what time we speak, when do we speak, because remember one thing, when we are talking of married couples, in connection with that, there is a familiarity that develops, there is an understanding over time. Whether one gets along or not, but you have a clear understanding of the other person so much. In fact, even between children and parents, so wherever there's an intimate atmosphere where you spend maximum time, you understand instinctively so many aspects, subtle aspects. And therefore, speech can be a very potent weapon. It can be like a brahmastra. Because only a person who knows only say a husband-wife situation. Husband would know exactly what word to say, when to say, and how to say it to really hurt the wife. And similarly, the wife also would know exactly what word to say, or just it just needs a word or two here and there. You know, you have a pinpointed Arjun-like arrow focus which goes straight to the heart, and it can have a tremendous impact. It can have a tremendous impact, and it is highly offensive. And most of us probably may be guilty of that offense. Then we don't realize it often, but it can have huge scars, because there is a story about this. There's this boy who, which illustrates this point. He was very hot-tempered. So his father told him once that they had a fence around their house. So he said, every time you lose your temper, you go and hit a nail on the fence. So the boy was obedient, so he started doing that. And very soon the whole fence got filled up. Every time he got angry, he used to... But while doing this, over time, slowly it started reducing. So his father said that for every day that you don't lose your temper, you can pull out one nail. So over time, gradually, it became a motivation for the son to try to remove the nails, and over time all the nails were removed, because he could control, you know, every day that he didn't lose his temper, he lost. So he was very happy. He went to his father and told him that, father, now all the nails are out. And the father took him to the fence and showed him, you know, all the marks that were there. So he said that you can remove the nails, but the scars remain. So the point for us is that oftentimes we may say that it is blown off and is gone off, but it leaves lasting impressions, and and the impact on the inner emotions are often not understood by anybody. Even we cannot understand subconsciously, but then maybe it may come into resentment if it's a frequent effect, or it may come into frustration, anger, and it may not be deliberate. Also, we may also apologize, which one should, but if we don't control that, or at least reduce it substantially, the impact it can have can be damaging. So therefore we need to remember that. And even Shastras also, like say Shringi's example, he got angry and he was a young boy, and in a momentary fit of anger, he just threw the dead snake on Parikshit Maharaj. And the rest is history. So Krishna's arrangement was such that we can see from one angle, but from his angle, from our understanding, what an anger can do, that and his father couldn't recognize that it was a very offensive, shouldn't do. Even Dhruv Maharaj, for instance, when he got very angry at the Yakshas, and he was practically single-handedly destroying the entire race of Yakshas, and then because he was very obedient disciple, and he stopped doing it, but still substantial damage can be done. So within relationships, speech is also a very critical aspect of what we speak, the tone, the motivation, the content, the insensitivity. So that's one aspect. Then also the fact that adjustments, accommodation, these are absolutely essential. We will have to cooperation, compromise. So actually we can see how spiritual principles help, because if we are following, we are constantly hearing about it as examples directly or indirectly when we hear other stories, we are always, and if we are sincere seekers, we will always get that the feedback as to our lifestyle has to be selfless, try to help others, which means that learn to accept faults we also have a faults, other people have faults. Don't overreact, adjust, accommodate. So these are basic principles which we need to be told repeatedly now more than ever, because in the past, say 50 years ago or 100 years ago, when we say divorces were less, very less, it was not that they had that there were problems were not there. People, you know, many wives were even mistreated even 50 years ago and 70 years ago as now, but their tolerance levels were astonishing. Their Krishna consciousness in the real sense was such that their devotion to, if they married a family, then it is, it's not the husband, it's only the family. They just accept it fiercely and loyally, and that's it. There's no question, and everything else is closed. So of course that period is gone. Unfortunately, the degradation of Kali Yuga, we can see that it is the effect, it takes place. But we can at least analyze and see that for those who are seeking, and it doesn't mean that one party has to abuse and the other party will suffer. But if there's a understanding and a compromise of and living with differences which are inevitably there, then that adjustment, that accommodation also helps. There's another example here. Yeah, this if there is a contentment and proper speech, at least to a certain harmony, then it brings up the easily the aspect of appreciation and gratitude, which is very, very crucial in all relationships. Just like, why do we feel it's so, you feel a sense of harmony in a temple or with a relationship with devotees or especially with our spiritual master? Why is it? If you see, there is deep appreciation. There is deep appreciation for Prabhupada and for the parampara. We are quick to point out, and we are very grateful for what we have been receiving. And in fact, the deeper we go, we then just see that the depth of our gratitude will have no end. We will just not understand how much we'll never understand how grateful we should be. So that is clear. But the principle here is that there is harmony because there is these aspects of both appreciation and gratitude, and therefore the more the appreciation, the less the chance of criticism also happens. So if the same principle is applied in our interactions with family members, particularly with our direct family, and it could be children, it could be relatives, parents, for those with whom we spend a lot of time, the chances are that we may just remove the mask and speak and act the way our native instincts bring up. If we do that, then the and it is not difficult to see so much appreciation on the other. That is not at all difficult. I mean, it is it really brings so much gratitude. For instance, if you are now say 40 years old and you have gone through 15 years of marriage, let's say, and then you have now the issues that have gone on 15 years. 15 years is a period when there's so many aspects happen. Even if we are not married, but we are with the parents, and then we realize when we grow older that how, you know, they may have lived with us. We have a greater understanding. They spend time with us, etc. So these relationships to develop appreciation because important, because the more the appreciation, the less the chances are that we will look at the negative. You can't have both the things. If you are having a positive feeling, positive expressions, and you can always say the glass is half full or half empty. So if you look at the positive side, then the chances are certainly that you will not see the other side. You will be looking at a different angle. So and that is exactly how we have been nurtured. When we have come in contact with devotees who have brought us slowly from, you know, the first contact, and then they spent time with us, they were focusing only on us. They never came there because they saw a perfect devotee come in front of them. This is a new person who's come, someone who's maybe curious or someone who's shown some interest in understanding, and because that devotee has had so much of gratitude of what he has received or what she has received, he or she wants to give it to anyone who comes. That here, you share it, you see, you experience it yourself, and then we see that, we experience it, and then we would like to give others. We become the insiders, so to say. That means we for us, this lifestyle, this philosophy, this becomes our whole and soul. So this becomes, then you never see, in our neophyte stage, we may criticize here and there that, you know, queues are very long, prasadam sometimes gets over, and in one festival I didn't get a chance for darshan. These are minor things, and that depends on our consciousness. But primarily the critical criticisms you rarely hear. Why? Because we have chosen to see it that way. We have chosen to see that way. Somebody who comes from outside and just comes into this room and sees, if they don't accept the philosophy, if they don't accept, renounced order, so many aspects of spiritual life, they will have a very critical attitude. So because we have now understood, we have a better understanding of, we have a better appreciation, and because of appreciation, that gratitude develops, and gratitude is critical. Sachinandan Maharaj, His Holiness Sachinandan Maharaj, very nicely summed. He said, Krishna deserts the heart of someone, I mean, Krishna takes away the bhakti from a heart which doesn't have gratitude. That means gratitude has to be soft. You cannot plant anything if there's no soft soil. So the softness of the heart comes from a grateful heart. And that grateful heart comes from appreciation, when we recognize how much we have got. And we actually do have that, because there's no way that we would be coming constantly to the temple without being grateful to our acharyas, paramparas, sadhus, our devotees who have helped us, etc. It is an instinctive thing. We don't even have to write it or actually sit down and think about it. But then we keep the principle in a compartment. We don't apply the principle, and we may somehow feel that because we're too intimate with the family members, so we feel that we are only seeing the faults. And then we see that, then you should be like so-and-so, you should be like so-and-so, you should be like this, you should be like that, not knowing that, well, we also have to be, applying the same things. So, and when we see how our senior devotees, acharyas, and how they actually deal with our family members, then, how they, because they look at the positive side, and they see that little bit of interest in improving our lives, immediately they will water it, they'll put a spark. So if we take those principles, there is a huge amount of opportunity for us to express our gratitude, and with that we can improve our lives. There are also certain challenges which are environmental, which may have nothing to do with A house or B house or C house, but this we have to recognize, especially for devotees. You know, there is when Saddam Hussein in Iraq was toppled, when US invaded Iraq, the primary reason they mentioned was that Iraq was developing weapons of mass destruction. They called it weapons of mass destruction, WMD. And which was a total lie. It was proven that he didn't have that. But they wanted a reason to come and conquer it. So that is history. But someone is gone, I'm not sure who, but brilliantly described that the weapons of mass destruction means there were such weapons, which supposedly, which could destroy thousands and thousands of bodies. But devotees have to face weapons of mass destruction, as is very nicely said, which actually affect thousands of minds. And that is the mass media. That could be TV, movies, the internet, social media. The mass distraction is which doesn't kill bodies but kills minds. Because you see, the soul is always seeking pleasure, and it seeks pleasure through the mind. And mind is primarily attracted to material things, unfortunately. That is the normal in this, till we actually reorient it later. So, because the mind, and the mind's nature is to jump from one object to another. The newness, the charm is very important. So, what becomes old gets discarded, goes to another one. And we see this, whether it is regarding somebody is watching TV, maybe flipping channels, somebody likes clothes, somebody likes cars, if they have the means for that. A variety of things, they'll keep doing it, depending on their interest, their capacity to spend, watches or whatever. So, even friends, even relationships, they want to find something new. And there it destroys the capacity to think. Our intellect actually gets diminished with this, and we don't have depth. We may have a superficial level, we may have an understanding of some material technical aspect, we may think it's brilliant, he can you can create a molecule, or you can do this and that, but he just doesn't have the basic understanding of basic principles, because they've lost the capacity to understand. Sometimes we say that how is it people cannot understand that this body is temporary? Such a basic thing, it is beyond, sometimes we feel it is beyond our imagination, but because they cannot even go below that level, even though they can see right there in the front of their eyes. And yet they may have, technically the IQ levels may be very high, but so just because of the part of the reason is that we have so many distractions. Then we also go by society opinions. You know, we have to avoid that, because we were very much influenced by how people look at us. Does this person like us? Does this we are anxious to know someone's opinions, and that happens because Chaitanya Charan Prabhu, in his beautiful book Gita for Daily Reflections, he says that the reason is because the tangible world is very clear. You know, I mean, we know we understand all the principles, and we hear from teachers, we hear from different people at different phases of life about the world. So therefore, but we don't know who tells us about the inner self. So till we actually start coming to a philosophy, Krishna consciousness, and we live it, then we start changing our orienting and saying that what is needed by the self. Otherwise, we are looking only from how the external world is, their opinions count, what they, how they will influence us, how they will see us, and we are guided only by that. So similarly, another problem is that there's so many temptations. There is no shortage of temptations, and there are enormous amount of temptation. The whole focus is only on creating more and more new objects which can distract us. So sometimes a devotee may feel depressed that I want to be pure, I want to get out of this, but I'm constantly affected by this, by these temptations. So there the question comes of how we have to tolerate it, because as very nicely explained, that you know, there is first the thought, and then there's the action. So having the thought in Kali Yuga is not a sin, fortunately. It was in the earlier yugas, but otherwise, you know, we wouldn't even have a chance. But at least we have a we. So, but acting on it. So, how to? You have to put a stopper between the temptations and the transgressions. You have a temptation, but you don't transgress, and that stopper is the tolerance. So, tolerance is really to develop that patience, accepting that you know, we are going to be. It's like how Haridas Thakur was flogged 22 times in 22 marketplaces. So that was a physical flogging which Chaitanya Mahaprabhu protected him. Similarly here, you can say we are flogged repeatedly at probably 2000 marketplaces of the temptations, you know, constantly being hit on the head. So, but if we have to just learn to tolerate, means just somehow not succumb to it. Somehow we have to fight that. So that fight, that's the struggle, that is where we can gradually develop. And how do we develop tolerance is basically intellectually by scriptures and spiritually by devotion. So we understand from the mind how our how the intellect should, means our intelligence guides us, is bathed in the philosophy of what we hear in the Bhagavatam, Bhagavad Gita, words of the acharyas and our present guru, and at the same time the activities, that becomes devotional service, and that helps us spiritually. That gives us, because you cannot just be thinking and saying that the mind alone will always change from one to another. So both the thought and the action can be purified by having these two tracks, that hearing and then implementing. So the action becomes our devotional service. And that, as we discussed today, devotional service is a variety of things. Whatever we do, the constant anxiety should be not what other people's opinions, but what Krishna's opinion would be. What is Krishna or Krishna's representatives? Am I letting them down? We shouldn't be worried about that how so-and-so will think and how so-and-so think. I mean, in the sense that we don't become so brazen that we humiliate or rude, be rude or insult, not that way. But when it comes to making choices, oftentimes we are curbed by the feeling that we are timid, or we will stop because we feel that I cannot speak up to this or that on a spiritual principle. But then that opinion, if it's going to make a major difference in your lifestyle, then it's a pity that we are actually allowing a mundane opinion to influence us. Rather, we should be looking at whose opinion counts when you have a choice. And if you're in doubt, we can always take consultations. I think we have run out of time. So I'll stop here. If there's any question or comments. Granthraj Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai.
Prabhuji, there is